Let us now discuss a bit about the strategy cards themselves. Strategy cards are the actual meat of the game. This is how a lot of things happen. The strategy cards are going to be played during the action round. The Axis player always takes the first action round of the turn, and then the players alternate playing action rounds. Whenever a player plays an action, this has to be recorded in the action rounds track, let's say, box. So if a card will be played for the operations points on that specific action round, the player will have to mark what kind of action round this is. So we would put the round marker on the ops round box. If the action card would have been a reinforcement card, then we would have marked on the reinforcements box. If the card would have been played for the replacements, for the RP value, then again this would have to be marked here. And of course, once a card is being placed played for the RP points, the RP value will be marked also on the general records track with the appropriate RP marker. In this case, we have a Soviet Blitzkrieg card, so the Soviet player would decide to play this card for the RP points, and the replacement points marker would mark how many RP points this is. This card has 3, so 3 it will be. These points will be later used during the replacements phase. Should the card be played for the event, then again we will mark the appropriate box, other events. Let's go back to the card. Let's say the player plays the card for the operations points value, in this case the 3. The player would mark appropriately the ops round, and we see that this box is green. That means the consecutive ops track marker would have to move, in this case, from the 0 to the first position. That means, full ops, the player will receive the full 3 operation points to conduct operations. On his next action round, if the player would play another card and again play it for the ops value, this would mean that again this round will be an ops round. The box is green to remind us that the consecutive ops track marker needs to move one box to the right. Now this time the player will not get the full ops. It will get the operation points value of the card minus what the consecutive ops marker box says. In this case, minus 1 ops. So this card played as ops in this case would give us 2 operation points to conduct operations. And so forth. So if a player consecutively plays cards for operation points, they will be each time receiving less operation points to conduct operations. As we said, the card can be played for the RP value or for the event. In this case, we see that both the replacement boxes and the other events box are gray, which means that once a card will be played for replacements or the event, and the appropriate round marker will be put there, the consecutive ops marker can be reset and will be reset. So this is a way to reset this marker back to zero. In other words, there is a penalty when one plays cards for the ops value on consecutive rounds. During the action rounds, a player can also play a zero ops round or a zero ops round where no units will be moved and no combat will happen. In that case, the player may also discard one card from his hand and get a new card. In this second scenario, we see also the different color of the box. The consecutive ops marker will be reset. In the first zero ops round scenario, where in which round a player can move all of his any and all of his units, and maybe even conduct combat by spending banked ops points, we will discuss about this later. In that case, the box is yellow, which tells us that the consecutive ops marker will stay where it is. It will not be reset, it will not be moved. Specifically to the Soviet player, the Soviet is allowed to play two reinforcements cards on turn two, and the second play will not touch the consecutive ops track. The German is only allowed one reinforcements card per turn. It is also shown on his action rounds box. To be mentioned here also that the consecutive ops track is never reset during a Rasputitsa during a Rasputitsa turn. Rasputitsa, we will discuss about this later, happens two times a year, biannually, during fall and spring. It's when the snow thaws during spring, and when rains start during fall, at which point the roads get muddy and certain situations are more difficult. So this is a simulation of these difficulties. During Rasputitsa rounds, the consecutive ops track will never be reset. A player can move any and all of his units when he plays a card for operations points, or whenever operation points will be spent, or in the case of a zero ops round where no card will be played, but the player can move any and all and or all of his units. In this case, also combat can happen due to banked operations points. Combat and certain movement needs to be paid for with operation points. These are the only things that cost operation points in this game. Generally, you can move everything without spending operations points. But there are some restrictions. The restrictions are if a player wants to move a unit that is in the zone of control of another enemy unit, like here for example, this unit is in the zone of control of the Hungarian, this is the Russian front, Romanian, sorry, is in the zone of control of this Romanian unit, this will cost an operation point. That's why we have the move markers to mark exactly the expenditure of operations point for this situation. This will cost an ops point so that this unit may be able to leave the zone of control of the enemy unit. Also, operations points are need to be spent for strategic movement. Strategic movement will follow the rail lines, and it will cost one ops point for SCU, for small combat units. Small combat units only are allowed. Only small combat units are allowed to conduct strategic movement, and it will cost one operations point per unit. So if one would want to spend three ops points and would like to conduct three units strategic movement, that would be three operations points. And of course, combat will have to be paid for with operations points. Each player will have five combat markers. And this is an absolute limit. So during an action round, only five tops combats can occur. For one combat marker, one operations point will be spent. So five ops for five combats. 4, 3, 2, 1, etc. There is an exception to paying with operations point in order to leave a zone of control of an enemy unit. If more units would have been on the hex where the enemy zone of control is, these units can freely leave the zone of control without paying, as long as one last unit, or as long as units remain in the hex. If even the last unit would to depart, that would cost an ops point. Also, should units move onto the hex with other units already being there, the units that were already on that hex in the enemy zone of control are not allowed to leave, to exit the hex, the zone of control, without the expenditure of ops value. Or, as it is stated in the rulebook, moving units into a hex during an action round does not allow all the units which started in that hex to be moved without expending an ops. Exception for spending ops will be advancing after combat. This doesn't cost any ops, and also no movement points will be spent. And exploitation. Strategic movement will be conducted either through railroads or through sea. After all movement has been completed, the active player may use any remaining ops to mark hexes with combat counters, combat markers. These may be placed on any hex, on any hex belonging to the active player. You mark your own hexes for combat. Then these hexes can initiate combat. The target of the attacks does not need to be specified in advance, and combat is voluntarily, and no unit is required to attack. A unit may move, including expending an ops for movement, if need be, and still initiate combat if an ops point was spent to place a combat marker on the hex that this unit will go once the movement is complete. And hexes can also be marked both for combat and movement. Of course, this will cost ops points. These are two
counters that will be placed, so two ops points. It's not that I will place both counters, so one ops point. No, no, no.
Also, during a zero ops round, where movement will happen and maybe combat due to banked ops, no blitz markers are allowed to be placed after combat. As we have said, should the strategy card be played for the RP, so it will be a replacement play, the player marks the play with the appropriate action marker and the appropriate box, and also with the RP marker on the general records track,
either for the Soviet player the appropriate number of RPs given, or for the Axis player,
depending on what kind of RPs are given, with the appropriate markers.
This one for Panzers, for normal German armies, or the rest of the German armies, and for the Axis minor allies.
Hungarian, Romanian,
Italian.
The Soviet player, as we see also here, can play two replacement cards per turn, or two cards as RP cards per turn. The Axis player may play a strategy card as an RP once per turn, with an exception during Spring 42 and Spring 43, where he can play a second replacement card, only these turns. There is also, the Axis player can also play a strategy card with an event that provides RPs as an event each turn. Players are not allowed to play an RP card, a card as an RP, on consecutive rounds, action rounds, but they are allowed to play a card as an RP on their last action round of a turn and then on the first action round of the next turn. If a card is played for the event, then whatever the text of the event will be implemented at once. Also, the player will have to mark the kind of action around it is, so other events in this case, and since it is a gray box, this also will reset the consecutive ops track if it needs resetting. Should the event have an asterisk, then this card will be removed from play. Also, events that their title is underlined are prerequisites for other events. An event, a card, can be played as an event card even if some of the text in the event cannot be implemented. So, lastly, there are the reinforcement events cards. These are event cards, but in this regard, these will be marked as reinforcement plays. Only one reinforcement card may be played per turn by each player. Here there is an exception. During turn 1, June 1941, neither player may play reinforcement cards, and the Soviet player may play two reinforcement cards during Soviet mobilization. That is turn 2 only. This we can also see on the Soviet action rounds box. There is reinforcements box first and second, which is in yellow, turn 2 only, the second reinforcement card, which in also, since it is in yellow, the consecutive ops track will not be reset. If a player cannot place all of the reinforcements listed on the card on the map, the card may be played, but units not placed are permanently removed from the game. So Axis reinforcing units will be placed in that nation's capital and or in any friendly controlled full supply sources, cities or fortresses in that nation. These need to be in full supply, and this will be judged as if there was a friendly unit on that hex. The Soviet player places units in a similar fashion, but may also place reinforcing units in towns that are in full supply. There are several exceptions noted on the invent cards, the cards that bring reinforcements, and as follows. Soviet total war fronts, front units that come as reinforcements in total war cards, are exchanged on a one-for-one basis for full or reduced strength, fully supplied on-map Soviet Blitzkrieg fronts. These units are listed in green text on the cards as a reminder, as such. Or as such. We place the total war front in the hex of the Blitz front they are replacing, while the replaced Blitz front is removed from the game. The total war front enters at full strength regardless of the strength of the removed front. Soviet total war guard armies with a G designation, 4G through 11G, are exchanged on a one-for-one basis for full or reduced strength, fully supplied on-map Soviet army only, SCUs. We will place the guard army in the hex of the Soviet army it is replacing. The replaced Soviet army is permanently removed from the game. These units are also listed in green text on the cards as reminders, as such. The guard army enters at full strength regardless of the strength of the removed Soviet army. Guard armies 1, 2 and 3 were formed directly, not from existing armies, and thus they will go onto the map without replacing any army. Soviet guard tank armies, the GT designation, are exchanged on a one-for-one basis for any full or reduced strength, fully supplied on map Soviet tank armies. Tank armies. Those with the T designation. We will place the guard tank army in the hex of the tank army it is replacing. The replaced Soviet army is permanently removed from the game. The replaced Soviet tank army. These units are also listed in green text on the cards as reminders, as such, on the bottom of the card. The guard tank army enters at full strength regardless of the strength of the removed tank army. If a Soviet reinforcement card brings on both guard tank armies and regular tank armies, those units can be placed in any order. Consequently, the regular tank armies that are placed are eligible to be replaced by the guard tank armies per the rules that were just stated. Italian units enter at Bucharest and or Odessa, in each case if Axis controlled. The capital of Hungary is Buda, and reinforcing units listed inside parentheses will be placed on the map on their weaker side. Lastly, we have combat cards. Combat cards are events that can be played during a combat to influence the combat. First, the attacker chooses whether to play combat cards and reveals those cards, then the defender does the same. If the player who plays the combat cards wins the combat, he is allowed to keep these open in front of them, and they can also be used in a different combat, not in the same round. There are also combat cards who feature an asterisk. In that case, these combat cards are immediately discarded, removed from the game, because these are events, asterisked events, they were played, they happened, that's it, they're done. The player who loses the combat and has played combat cards has to discard these cards. The loser, the defeated party of the combat, is not allowed to keep their combat cards, only the winner. At the end of a turn, any combat cards that have been held because of won combats are discarded. That's it. From turn to turn, no combat cards can be used, can be transferred. No player may ever have a hand size greater than 7 cards. No player may ever have a hand size less than 4 cards, with the exception that the Axis player does not have a minimum hand size on turns 16, 17, 18, the last 3 turns of the game. The hand size may change because of control of oil hexes or the play of certain events that reduce hand size. Both players can discard any or all of the strategy cards that they still have in their hand before they draw new cards. Players may examine the cards that their opponent discards. If a player needs to draw a strategy card but their draw pile is empty, reshuffle the discards to form a new draw pile. Total War is triggered at the beginning of the card draw phase if it is turn 6 or later, and either of the following conditions are satisfied. Either player has removed 12 asterisked strategy cards from the game by playing them as events, or the players combined have removed 20 asterisk strategy cards from the game by playing them as events. Total War can never be triggered before turn 6. When Total War is triggered, each player will add their Total War cards to all their discards and undrawn Blitzkrieg cards and reshuffle them to form a new draw pile. Let's talk about Zones of Control, or ZOCs. The following units have Zones of Control when in full supply: all large combat units, Soviet mechanized corps, tank armies and guard armies, and German panzer corps. No other units have zones of control. Units that do not have zones of control are indicated by the presence of a white square at the border of their playing piece. Also, units in fortress supply have no zone of control. Zones of control extend into all adjacent squares, hexes, with the following exceptions. Zones of control do not extend across impassable hex sites, like lake and sea hex sites. They do not extend into fortress or festung hexes. Axis zones of control do not extend into a hex with a Soviet fortified zone marker. All units must stop upon entering an enemy zone of control. Units in an enemy zone of control may only exit the hex if a friendly unit remains in the hex, like here for example. One of those two units can freely leave. Or if an ops point is spent to allow the units to move. Units may not move directly from one enemy ZOC to another, or from here, here, and so on. Or retreat or trace supply through an enemy ZOC. Exception here, friendly units negate enemy ZOC for retreat and supply only. ZOCs have no effect on advance after combat or exploitation. Let's talk about stacking. A maximum of 4 combat units may stack per hex. Only one large combat unit may stack per hex. Never more. The following unit types do not count for stacking, but there may only be one of each type per hex: Stalin counter, the bunker, the Soviet fortified zone, and partisans, active or inactive. Stacking is in effect at all times, except during regular and strategic movement, exploitation and retreat. Although it applies at the end of movement, at the end of exploitation, and at the end of retreats. Hungarian and Romanian units may never stack in the same hex. Partisans may never stack with any other Soviet units. Now let's talk about movement. Clear hexes cost one movement point to enter, regardless of the presence of towns, cities, fortresses, or festungs. Movement costs for all other terrain types are listed on the terrain effects chart. There. If multiple terrain types exist in a hex, the unit pays the greatest of the associated MP costs. For example, the Astrakhan hex, we can see it has a city and a swamp. The city would normally cost one movement point to enter, the swamp two movement points, so in this case two movement points will be paid to enter Astrakhan, not two plus the one from the city. Movement must be from hex to adjacent hex. Hexes may not be skipped. So the ZOC army here has two movement points. Thus, it will be one, two, or one, two, starting from this hex. One, I'm not entering the desert hex because, according to the terrain key and terrain effects chart, it costs two movement points to enter the desert hex, and I don't have, or this unit doesn't have the two required because it started its movement on this hex. If it would have started the movement, the move on this hex, the adjacent hex to the desert, then two movement points it has. One, two, and that would be it. A unit may never spend more movement points than its movement allowance in a single turn, of course. Two, two it will be. Three, three. Unused movement points cannot be accumulated for future turns or transferred to other units. For example, this unit, we wanted it to move here, one MP. We still have one point left. We don't want it to move here. We don't want it to move here. We cannot enter the desert hex. That's it. We finish this unit's move here. And the rest, the one movement allowance that has not been spent, it's done. There is an exception here. This game has a lot of exceptions, by the way. Units may always move a single hex only, even if the cost of that move would ordinarily be greater than their movement allowance, provided that this movement is legal in every other way. That's why I have this example here. It's also in the rulebook. This ZOC army, it has two movement allowance. To enter the mountain hex here or here, it would need three movement points, but under this exception it can move and finish the movement there. Of course, it cannot move further, and that's about it. Supplied Axis units that start their move east of the Paulus logistical line on turns 1 through 4 have their movement allowance reduced by 1. This is very, 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 very important for those units, those Axis units that will have crossed the Paulus logistical line during turns 1 through 4. Although I would like to see in turn 1 a German unit reach and pass the Paulus logistical line. Okay, maybe it can be done. I have not manage this. Yeah, most probably with strategic movement. So, Paulus logistical lines, any supplied Axis units that start their move east of the line from turns 1 to 4, they have one less movement allowance. Units may not enter a hex that contains enemy units, and we have a small exception here again. Axis units may move through and stack with inactive Soviet partisans. So these are the partisans, a partisan counter. It has an inactive side and an active side. So if it is inactive, an Axis unit may move through or stack with it. As we have already mentioned, if a strategy card is played as an ops card, a player may also use strategic movement to move SCUs, small combat units. Strategic movement occurs at the same time as regular movement. However, a unit cannot use normal movement or attack on the same round that it uses strategic movement. It will cost one ops point per small combat unit to move by rail or by sea. A player may expend ops to conduct strategic movement during the same action round that ops are also spent for their movement or attacks. Yes, okay, of course. Units may move any distance by rail along rail lines. We have rail lines everywhere on the board. They may begin their move in an enemy zone of control, provided the hex contains another friendly unit. So, let's set up a small example. So, we have units here in an enemy zone of control. The hex contains another friendly unit, and that unit will not use strategic movement. In this case, it is an LCU, so it cannot use. We could set the example with two SCUs. So we have set here an example. So we have two units in an enemy zone of control. One of them is allowed to use strategic movement and leave that enemy zone of control because there is another friendly unit in the hex, and that friendly unit will not use strategic movement. Then this one that will use strategic movement cannot enter another enemy zone of control. So if this Axis unit, this Panzer unit, would have been here, and one would have wanted to strategic move this mechanized army to the north, let's say, it is not allowed because by leaving the hex, it enters again enemy zone of control, and that cannot be done. So it needs to be free of enemy zone of control. Axis units using rail movement may ignore one inactive partisan unit, but must stop upon entering a second such hex in a single rail move. Inactive, let's say. Now, partisans have also specific rules for positioning. Now we'll put this unit here. And let's assume that this unit starts strategic movement from this hex, so it can ignore the first partisan unit and continue along the rail, but upon entering a second such hex, It has to stop. A player may use all rail hexes for rail movement, provided they can trace an uninterrupted line of rail hexes free of enemy units, enemy zone of control, or enemy-controlled city, oil, victory point, port, fortresses, hexes, to a friendly supply hex. So the uninterrupted line of rail hexes needs to trace to a friendly supply hex. And during that movement through the rails, it cannot pass through any enemy units. This is also, it goes against movement. No enemy unit, no unit can enter a hex with an enemy unit. So, okay, this makes sense. No enemy zones of control. No enemy controlled city, oil, victory point, ports or fortresses, hexes. And yes, we guess correctly, there is an exception. Axis units, of course, may not use rail movement in the USSR during turns 1 through 4.
Somewhere here are the borders of USSR.
So Axis units are not allowed to use rail movement during turns 1 through 4 in the USSR, or they are also not allowed to use rail movement in the Baltic Republics, Latvia, Estonia, Lithuania, during turns 1 and 2. Axis units may never use rail movement in the Caucasus zone, and the Caucasus zone, as we have mentioned, is south of the Caucasus logistical line. So this is the Caucasus logistical line. Thus, the Caucasus zone will be the area here. And Soviet units may never use rail movement in Germany. We should also mention that the bunker small combat unit is not allowed to use strategic movement. It makes sense because this represents the forces that were in the bunker, in the Berlin bunker. That's why it only has a defense number and it doesn't have any movement allowance. Okay, the movement allowance is not relevant in strategic movement, but thematically, somehow, yeah, okay. The Axis player may use strategic movement to sea move one small combat unit per turn in the Baltic Sea, and one small combat unit per turn in the Black Sea, Sea of Azov. The unit must start and end its move in a friendly port. The presence of enemy ZOC does not prevent such a move, and may not move east of a port under Soviet control. In this case,
this unit here, using strategic movement, let's say we pay one ops, and it will see move to a friendly control port. Let's say that this was also controlled friendly control for whatever reason. We have the port symbol, and the enemy zone of control
is irrelevant. The presence of this does not prevent the move.
But if this situation would have been like this, and here we would have
Soviet control, it is not allowed
to see move this unit to this port, because it would move
to the east of a port under Soviet control. Same will happen in the Sea of Azov. Sea of Azov. Now, the Soviet player may use strategic movement to C-move one small combat unit per action round. This is a big difference. The Axis, they may C-move one small combat unit per turn. So, once in a turn. First turn, second turn, third turn, so forth, so on. The Soviet player, per action round, one small combat unit. So, five times per turn. But they may use C movement in the Black Sea, Sea of Azov only. So, only here. The unit must start its move in a friendly port, but may move to any non-enemy controlled hex, regardless of the presence of enemy ZOC, but never west of an Axis controlled port. So this unit here can see move to this port, but cannot see move to this port, because that would mean to move to the west of an Axis controlled port. The naval evacuation event allows the Axis player to evacuate any one large combat unit from a port hex to another friendly port hex further west. The large combat unit, the LCU, is automatically reduced to its last step strength. This is the naval evacuation card. It's a total war card. And it states that one Axis large combat unit may move from port to any port to the west. That's why evacuation, because from the east they will go to the west. The large combat unit is reduced to its last step strength. And there is a 1945 situation if this card is played during 1945. A player may attempt to build a trench in a hex containing one of his large combat units, his LCUs, by expending one ops. The LCU may not move, but other units in the hex may move freely. After all movement for the action round is complete, the player rolls a die for each hex which has an LCU attempting to entrench. If the die roll is 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1 through 3, 1, 2, 3, okay, it was correct. Place a trench marker in that hex, either like this or like this, however. Only one entrenchment attempt can be made per hex per action round. There is a note here that the Soviet player may attempt to entrench only after play of the People's Militia event, of course, and the Axis only after play of the Hedgehogs event. These are events that grant the capability to the respective players to entrench, to attempt entrenchments. Friendly trenches are removed from the map either when the hex becomes enemy controlled or enemy occupied, or as the player chooses during the end of turn phase. If one remembers, during the end of turn phase, the Axis player may remove friendly trench markers from the map. The Soviet player may remove friendly trench markers from the map. The number of trench markers provided with the game is an absolute limit. And they are 4 for the Axis and a bit more for the Soviet. 8. Double the number. Trenches must be placed in spaces containing an LCU, even when placed as a consequence of an event. For example, the People's Militia card, which also grants the capability to the Soviet player to build trenches, states, place one trench marker, dot. Soviets may make entrench attempts thereafter. Place one trench marker. We don't simply place a trench marker wherever we wish. Oh, here we have a trench marker. No. The trench marker needs to be placed with an LCU.